Hi everyone, welcome to the Java course. When we want to do some tasks repeatedly, we can make use of the for loops. And in the for loop, we have to make sure that we understand the operation of it. So let us see some examples. In every for loop, we have three components essentially. We have the initialization part, the test part, and the change part. What does it mean by these three terms? Let us take some examples. Suppose I now have a variable called I, which is an integer. And now I is not storing any value. So how can I make use of this I to do some iteration? We can control the repetition by using the three components mentioned above. This part is the initialization part, so I would initialize I to be 0. And if this value of I can pass the test shown in the middle part, we will do the thing inside the for loop. And after doing the thing inside the for loop, we will change the value of I on the third part of the for statement surrounded by the round brackets. So what can I do for this example? I can do something like this. I just want to print out the value of I during the iteration. And after doing the iterations, I need to print out the value of I as well. I'm going to check the result of the for loop on the value of I. Let me save it, run it. Okay, for this for loop, I'm able to print out the string like this for four times. The first one is the case when I is equal to 0, and after doing this printing statement when I is equal to 0, the value of I would be incremented by 1, so that I becomes 1. When I becomes 1, it is still passing the test condition shown in the middle of the conditions there. So I can still print out I is 1, and then I would become 2 by following the change rule here. And it is still possible to do the looping because 2 is still smaller than 4, so I can print out this line. And when I becomes 3, the test condition is also allowed, so we will do the printing for this one, and then I would become 4. But when I becomes 4, this test condition fails, so we don't do the printing of 4 by doing the iterations again. So after finishing the iteration, the value of I would become 4. So the value of 4 is printed after doing the iterations. Since this I is the it's declared before we do the for loop, this I is still present. It means that the scope of this variable is still there even after the for loop, so we can still print out the value of 4. But we can see that it's usually not the most feasible approach of using a for loop, because usually we would constrain the scope of the looping index to be just inside the for loop. In order to do that, we can do something like this, which is a more suggested way. Okay, for the current for loop, the initialization of the loop counter is inside the parentheses following the for keyword. It means that this variable j is just having the scope inside this for loop. So when we want to use the value of j after the for loop, we are not allowed to do so because it already dies. Oh, here it should be j. If I want to print out the value of j, I can do something like this in order to test whether it is possible to print it out. Let me save it and run it. You see, I will have an error here because j is already out of the scope of the for loop. For this situation, j is already an undefined variable which is not allowed to do the printing. So I comment it and then I save it, run it. Okay, this looping is allowed because j is having the scope inside this for loop and the logic is the same as before. I just increment the value of j by 1 after printing out one line of statement, and the looping would stop when j is equal to 5. So the last line would just be j equals 4. As we mentioned, there are three parts in a for loop condition. The initialization part, the test part, and the change part. Is it possible to eliminate one of them? Yes, conceptually. So let us see how we can handle the situations when one of these essential parts are ignored. Suppose I have a variable called k which is initialized as 2. Okay, for this iteration, what does it mean by removing the initialization part? It is simply saying that I will use the value of k initialized already before the for loop. So it is equivalent to saying that k equals 2 is the initial value of k. So let us see the result. Save it, run it. Okay, the value of k starts with 2 and then it will be incremented by 1 every time I do the printing, and the value of k would stop at 5 on the console, because when k equals 6, this for loop is not allowed to perform its action inside the for loop. And after doing the printing, I can still print out the value of k. Why is it the case? Because the variable k is declared outside the scope of the for loop. So let me run it again. Yes, the value of k is 6, which is obtained by changing it from 5 to 6 using the increment command and instruction. And then how about removing or ignoring the test part? we can see the effects of it in this example. In this for loop, the test condition is removed. It means that we don't do the testing after the increment instruction in the change part. So we can expect that the loop will continue to run indefinitely. Let us see the result. The initialized value of m is 3, so we can be sure that the printing would start with m equals 3. Yes, I need to stop it because I don't need to do the looping all the time. Yes, it is an infinite loop, and the loop would start with m equals 3, and it won't stop because there is no checking of the test condition. So it is possible that the looping would continue all the time. So we have to consider the situation with care. If we ignore the test condition, it is quite possible that we will have an endless loop, which is not something we want to see. And how about ignoring the change part? Here, we can see the effect of it with the next example. Okay, I can do the for loop like this. If I don't do the change of the value of the loop index inside the declaration surrounded by the parentheses, we can do so inside the for loop. So I have a statement to do the increment after doing the printing action. So the effects will be equivalent to doing the addition in the change part of the for loop. So let me save it and run it to see the result. Okay, J starts with 2, and after doing the printing, J would be increased by 1 so that it becomes 3. 3 is still smaller than 7, so the test condition is passed. We can do the printing again to let people know that J becomes 3. And we can continue to do the rest of the printing until J becomes 6. And when J becomes 6, we can do the printing, and then J would become 7, which violates the test condition here. So we don't do the printing of J equals 7. And after a series of introduction of the for loops, I hope you are able to understand the way we can control the iteration by using different approaches. This is the end of the video. If you have any questions about my video, feel free to leave your comments on the comment section below the video. If you like this video, please give me a like and please subscribe to my channel. Thank you for watching.